So when we look at all of the intelligence theories that we have, and we start to look at all of the personality theories we have, you find that it isn't a concluded topic, right? Personality is complex. I already pointed this out before. There are a lot of different perspectives on it. But what we're trying to do is a connected series of statements intended to establish a proposition. It isn't just saying, no, it isn't. You have to actually have data to bolster or refute somebody else's argument. Either you're bolstering your own argument or you're refuting somebody else's argument. So we have all of these kind of nebulous constructs going around from psychoanalytic perspectives and humanistic perspectives. But what are these things that we call personalities anyway? And as I said before, when you think about your personality, you probably start thinking of a few descriptor words, a few adjectives. When you think about your own best friend or your mother or your father or somebody you grew up with, or somebody you work with, you don't think about their id and their ego and their superego, right? You think about these descriptors, these adjectives, these concepts, whether they're trustworthy, whether they're friendly, whether they're whatever, whatever, whatever. The concepts are the labels we apply to what we think are relatively stable patterns of behavior, right? So that we have consistency, and that consistency is what we consider to be identity. And that identity, we think, is going to be part of a person's life. Gordon Allport kicked it off, really, in the trait theory, identifying more than 4,500 traits on three levels. 4,500 traits. How did he do this? He was looking through the dictionary. And what he found was adjective after adjective after adjective that can be used to describe human beings to one another or to oneself. And by looking at that, he tried to organize this into what he thought were cardinal traits. Cardinal traits are relatively rare. Cardinal traits dominate most of your life, so that you're affected by a central aspect of your personality. I should be careful with the word central. Total pacifism, for example, became the guiding principle for almost everything that Martin Luther King Jr. and Gandhi did in their public lives, right? They were pushed like normal human beings into some very, very uncomfortable positions by highly aggressive people who most of us would then react to aggressively or at least defensively. But that cardinal trait caused them to react differently than most people would. And in that sense, they were unique. But for most of us, we have these general kinds of personality traits that we engage in on a day-to-day basis. Let's see if I can get that up here. For most of us, we have central traits and secondary traits. In other words, a cardinal trait is rare because there's rarely one trait that guides almost all of our behavior. Right? Lots of traits, theoretically, contribute to who we conceive ourselves to be. Central traits would be prominent and general traits, building blocks of personality, where Gordon Allport thought most people had 5 to 10 of these. Secondary traits are dispositions that vary from situation to situation that often flow out of these central traits. You display them occasionally depending on the situation, but they're not totally inconsistent with your central traits. Raymond Cattell came along and used a technique we call factor analysis. It's a statistical approach to understanding and analyzing data to take this massive number of traits and reduce them into what he thought were 16 basic traits, the ones that for him are central traits. Now, for each of those 16 traits, he would have thought there were other sub-traits that were important to understand. Now, I just highlight these because that's the history of it. And then we move on to more test-relevant material. And we get into Hans Eysenck. Hans Eysenck looked at traits slightly differently. It's almost like there's that old game show, Name That Tune. You say, I could name that tune in 8 notes. Somebody else goes, I can do it in 5 notes. Somebody else goes, I can do it in 4 notes. They go, name that tune. See if you can name a tune in 4 notes, right? And it's almost like you got Allport saying it's a bunch of traits, and then you've got Cattell going, it's 16 traits. And then you got Eysenck going, it's 3 traits, but I'm really going to emphasize 2 traits. So you're looking at different people arguing over very similar principles and looking for evidence. So he says there's 3 bipolar trait dimensions. And when I say bipolar, I mean one extreme versus the other extreme. When we get to the big 5, it should become apparent what I'm talking about. But one bipolar dimension that he thought was prominent in all human beings was introversion versus extroversion. Now, most people say, oh, yeah, he's extroverted, or she's kind of shy, she's sort of introverted. And they have a general sense of what that means. Those descriptors have been around a long time, since at least the Socratic school of philosophy, Aristotle and the like. For Eysenck, it's really about physiological levels of arousal. For him, it's looking at what kind of state of arousal are you typically in, and you usually seek its opposite. So that if you have low levels of physiological arousal characteristically, you would seek higher levels of arousal by engaging the social world or being really outgoing, or bravado might be part of that. That gets into some subdivisions of these. But if you already have lots of internal arousal and you already have this kind of characteristic high level of arousal, you seek the opposite. You seek calm. You seek serenity. You seek not necessarily social isolation, because introverts aren't people who don't have any social relationships. They have chosen relationships. It's not that they can't engage in social activities, but they prefer more often than not more solitary activities. Now, if you see these as extremes, then you can imagine a normal distribution being laid on that bipolar dimension, where very few people are extremely extroverted all the time, and very few people are extremely introverted all the time. Where would you expect them to be? Toward the middle. Maybe leaning this way or leaning that way, predominantly. But situationally, we might see people, for example, in a job interview, if you're very introverted, you might be assertive in a job interview, for example. Somebody who gets up on stage and talks a lot in front of large numbers of people doesn't do that all the time. Sometimes they like to just have a quiet book and sit at home and maybe watch Jeopardy or something like that. Just quiet time, reading, or watching some kind of TV or listening to music. So you see that nobody seems to display all of these traits in all situations, but that you have a characteristic level of preference for introversion versus extroversion, which he's explaining as a genetic basis, saying that there's some heredity involved here. He also looked heavily at this neuroticism and emotional stability. Now you see I've got these 2 bolded in addition to having Hines Eysenck being white fonted. So neuroticism and emotional stability really looks at a person's reactivity to life. Some people are pretty stoic. It takes a lot to rattle them, and even when they get rattled, they don't look that rattled to the rest of us, right? They seem to take everything in stride, maybe aren't that emotional at all. Could that be problematic, to show no emotion? It could be if you were extreme on the trait, because that would make it hard to connect to other people. But very few people are that stoic or that stable. On the other side, you have people that might be easily rattled, easily flip out over quite little problems that come up in their life. And they have a lot of lability, meaning they move up and down in their emotions all the time. And that can be an instability. And that instability can be problematic. Now, most people aren't extremely unstable or extremely stable. Most people toward the middle. They lean towards one or towards the other, depending on the situation. And he looked at these 2 different traits as explaining a lot of personality. He had this other thing called psychoticism and impulse control. Impulse control, the ability to restrain one's impulses, right? Where people, you could be over-controlled, right? You never take a chance. You never take a risk. You never go outside your comfort zone. You don't grow because you're rigid. And the other side would be, you do anything that comes to mind, regardless of the consequences, overly impulsive. And of course, most people aren't one extreme or the other. They're towards the middle, leaning one way or the other. Well, for your own tests and knowledge, he really emphasized more the 1 and the 2. And I'll show you a graphic here of how that worked. He thought there were higher order traits. Major trait would be extroversion, for example. But he didn't think that was the only trait. If you have somebody who's extroverted, it gives rise to these kind of secondary or suborder traits, lower order traits, like assertiveness. Right? So out of extroversion, you could get assertiveness or aggressiveness. They're not the same thing. And not everybody who's extroverted would be aggressive, and not extroversion does not guarantee assertiveness in every situation. And so he looks at these first two domains as really explaining habit, which is to say our stable aspects of personality, and specific responses, which is to deal with situations, how we as people deal with situations. So higher order govern lower order traits. When you look at his two-dimensional model of personality, where we have stability versus instability, right, what he would call neuroticism, and you have introversion versus extroversion, on this graph you can kind of look and see it as a normal distribution. Very few people are extremely introverted or extremely extroverted or extremely stable or extremely instable. Most people are going to be tending towards the middle, leaning towards introversion or towards extroversion, leaning towards instability or leaning towards stability. But he would say that you could map these out, that a person who was highly extroverted and highly stable, right, be sociable, maybe even a leader, right, responsive, talkative. So you see this quadrant is a combination of people who have stable emotional natures who are also extroverted. Flip that over, and people who are introverted and unstable, you have that kind of moodiness, anxiousness, rigidness, social isolation, pessimism. But again, most people aren't extreme. But you swing it around from introverted to stable, and you see that these become different adjectives. We're looking at thoughtful, peaceful, controlled, reliable, even tempered. And on the flip side of extroverted and unstable, we start going to impulsive, excitable, aggressive, restless. It's an interesting concept because it explains a lot with two bipolar dimensions or traits.